Hello everyone, I wish you a good day and thank you very much for attending. My name is Ioan Adrian Ratiu and will be presenting to you today a mechanism which helps you simplify your driver code by using an upstream kernel mechanism named Regmap. It's actually a subsystem. Okay, so let's see an overview of the presentation. We will first talk about who is this for and a little bit about me. Then we will see what's the problem which we try to solve. Then we describe the solution, do some case studies. We have two driver case studies, and then see where we could go forward from here. So I am a consultant software engineer. I work for a company called Collabora, and I mostly do hardware bring up, embedded product development, embedded Linux distributions. I'm a huge fan of projects like Yocto, and I also do device drivers. And during my experience with device drivers, over time I saw some patterns which are quite always repeating in device driver development. And this is what this is all about. So my presentation is mainly aimed at driver developers, because that's the subject of the presentation, but not necessarily only driver developers. It can be aimed for Linux developers in general, because what we're using is an upstream Linux kernel mechanism, which is available to all, for example, Linux kernel developers. Of course, the number of Linux kernel developers which are not driver developers is very small. But yeah, this pattern can also be used in user space. I've seen a lot of drivers using in user space the same pattern. And yeah, it's also for those who just want like to see better drivers, or are sick of seeing so many drivers for so many very similar devices, or each system on a chip coming with its own driver for a particular piece of hardware. And yes, so it's quite a broader audience than just driver developers, which I'm targeting. So this is why this is mostly an introduction to the subject. Okay, so a quick disclaimer before going forward. I'm not presenting something like snake oil here. This is not a silver bullet. It will not fix all bugs. This is just a mechanism which is easy to use and will help make drivers better by reusing code in the drivers. So it's also upstream kernel friendly. If you use this mechanism, you can very easily upstream your driver. And of course, there are pros and cons to this solution. For example, yeah, it's a Linux only solution, and maybe you want your drivers to run also on other systems. You don't want to tie them to Linux. And yes, the main idea with this is that it can avoid bugs by sharing code and avoiding each driver doing its own thing independently and reinventing much of the wheel. Okay, so going forward, we're gonna look a bit at the problem space. So we have multiple hardware integration levels, but I wrote here in the slide just one integration level. So you have a lot of vendors who do hardware and do their own IP. This can be like USB host controllers, they can be video decoders or even video cards, and not necessarily video cards, but cores which do decoding and stuff like that. And those can be integrated on a system on a chip, and multiple versions of those are integrated on each system on a chip. And driver developers, what they usually do is they target the system on a chip. So they're at the bottom of the stack, how you can imagine. So driver developers usually have to cope with different versions. A lot of versions come from the first vendors which do the actual IP hardware, and the integrators, they can also add their own special sauce. For example, they can add a control layer with a control block for a specific device or multiple devices, which needs to be programmed independently of the no upstream device. That could be used to handle power management for the device or control the clocks and stuff like that. So at each layer you can have multiple versions, and yeah, each version can add its own special sauce. And what interests us the most is, well, hardware breakages. So hardware interface breakages, this is the thing which affects driver developers the most. So typically, hardware vendors are focused on optimizing the hardware and implementing new specs of the hardware and, in general, evolving the hardware. They're not necessarily super focused on keeping backwards compatibility in terms of programming the hardware. That could really ease the life of driver developers, but yeah, usually that's rare. And typically, the programming protocols and the hardware behavior, they tend to stay the same. You don't have huge jumps between hardware revisions, and most of the time they're backwards compatible. When there's like this huge jump between two different hardware versions and they are incompatible even with behaviors, not only just at the register layout where you communicate with the device, then you might need a new driver and there's no way around it. But usually you only have incremental breakages. So each new version might shuffle some registers, might move or add some new features which require some new register fields. And typically this is compensated in the driver software. Yes. So this is the problem which driver developers encounter quite a lot. It's register shuffling. So the interfaces of the hardware, they change. And this can be due to a lot of factors, which are typically outside of the control of the software developers, because if software developers could control this, they would try to maintain backwards compatibility. Sometimes the hardware interface changes because the hardware evolves, and there are new use cases like 8K video decoding, which supports much higher resolutions, and the previous hardware versions, they didn't have fields to fit the bigger resolutions for 8K. So you had to modify those registers to make them bigger to accept bigger values and stuff like that, or new features like adding stride support for images which you decode. Yes. So the breakages can also be due to non-technical reasons. This might be like business reasons, which make sense to optimize the cost by merging two cores or stuff like that. And typically how device drivers solve this problem, they do bit manipulation. That's the only way to work around this. If your register fields change, well, you can only start shifting, masking, and in general, apply bit manipulation, bit magic tricks to compensate and write the correct values in the correct places. And yes, many drivers, what they do is they create an abstraction layer on top of this to don't have to constantly do those bit manipulations. They define a structure, which is like a generic register, and they program the hardware register layout using that structure. Basically, this is what we also do using Regmaps, the way how we do it. So, using Regmaps to that kind of thing. So, a little bit about Regmaps. It's an upstream kernel mechanism. It's upstream since it's a subsystem in the Linux kernel. It's been upstream for a decade now, and gradually over the years, quite a lot of features have been added to it. And initially, it was for non-memory mapped buses like SPI or I2C, but over time, MMIO support was added, and a register field interface was also added to Regmaps for bit level access. So with register fields, you can define sub-register accesses, like even for one bit in a register, and you can tell the Regmap API, look, I just want to write this one bit, keep all the values the same, use mask, do all the bit manipulation in the background, and yeah, it provides bit level access. So We're gonna take a look from the bottom up, starting from the hardware going to the kernel, to the registers, to the drivers. So you can see here I created two versions of hardware. So you can see those are registers, and the registers are 32 bit wide. Those values are actually in hexa, and I set the same values for the same register fields. So for example, register 1, which is filled with zeros in version 1, is 32 bit wide, and in version 2 you can see that half of it is 1 and half of it is 0. So the register field layout changed for version 2, and you can see that the layout changes for all the registers, and that happens with hardware revision, and it's quite a pain. You can see if you memory map into the CPU memory, you have like a linear memory of those registers, and on top of that linear memory, you can define with a regmap, with the regmap field API, which we're interested in here, you can define fields in the region. So you can see we define field 1 to be the first zeros, and then in the version for version 1, and in the second version, the field is at different offsets. And the advantage of doing this and defining regmap fields like this is that the driver can program the hardware targeting the regmap field API. So the driver doesn't need to know exactly at which offset, which register or field has moved, how big it is. This is very important because the regmap fields can also change sizes, and the regmap subsystem in the background, while you call the API, it does all the bit manipulation which you need, which is pretty cool because the regmap subsystem is very well tested and there's no bugs. There were quite a lot of bugs when implementing regmaps for certain drivers which I encountered, just because each driver elected to implement their own like bit manipulation logic. They have like a header, and in the header they define all the registers and fields within the registers, and they have all the shifts, and yeah, that's a really common source of bugs which regmaps can help you avoid. Okay, so this was like a bottom-up view. We will change now for a top-to-bottom view. So we start from user space. Of course the user space can be different, but in this example I just use like a multimedia user space using the Video for Linux subsystem. The user space calls into the Video for Linux subsystem, which has bindings for the driver and the core driver logic, which implements whatever the driver supports. In our case, it's a video decoder, so it has H.264 and H.265 codec functionality. Basically, it decodes bitstreams of compressed frames in those formats. And the idea is that the driver core programs the hardware using the register fields, which we looked at before. And this is very good for the driver because it can reuse all the core logic and they can focus on writing the core logic instead of worrying about different hardware revisions. Yes. And this, having this kind of abstraction layer between the core driver logic and the hardware, allows you to very easily add new hardware revisions to the driver, because most of the code in the driver doesn't change, only the register layout or very little of the actual interface changes. Okay, let's see how we define some register fields. You can see that we have like a configuration for the regmap itself. This configuration tells that the registers are 32 bit wide, the stride is 4. We can have like a maximum register offset. This can be used for bounce checking. And we also disable locking, because in our use case we don't need that. But if you have like concurrent accesses or accesses from atomic contexts, like IRQ context, then you could have locking. Okay, so we also define a field configuration and we populate the fields. So the field configuration naming is a bit unfortunate. The field configuration uses a structure named regfield, and the API exposed by the regmap field API is called regmap field. So you have reg field versus regmap field. So this can be a source of confusion. So the shorthand one, reg field, is for configuring the register layouts, and the regmap field is for the API, which we will see. So if you look at these two fields, which are the XCBus read and write IDs, we configure this at different offsets in a register map for different versions. The first version is named G1 and the second version is named VC8000D. And you can see that these fields, they have different sizes and live at different offsets within the device register space. The first live at offset 16 and 30, and the second version, the registers live at register 77. Yes, they were put together and they were increased in size. So you can define any number of register fields, and this is how it works in general. And it's quite verbose, and this is, I think, a good thing, because as we will see in the pros and cons discussion, when you define the register fields very explicitly like this, like this is the address and it starts from bit 0 to bit 15, when you do it like this, it's very close to the datasheet, because these values were taken from a publicly available datasheet. In this case, it's from the NXP IMX8 datasheet, and they are very easy to compare with the datasheet, because they are exactly the same numbers. You have software register SWREG 77 starting from 0 to 15. You can just like do a one-on-one comparison. This is very hard to do if you have bit shifts and all the bit magic there, because you don't really know. You have to decode mentally that code. Yeah, so this is one of the biggest advantages. Now, the second advantage is that you can define an abstract API on top of the register fields. So we define the regmap field. You can see that we use the full name regmap field, and this can be different from the configuration names. So in the configuration, you can have any kind of names which resemble the hardware, but it's known that certain hardware revisions, you use different names for different versions to refer to the same thing or almost the same thing. And yeah, you can use this API to like virtualize a lot of stuff, like create common terminology for registers. And what you need to do is this API, each field in the API needs to be associated at runtime with each configuration for the specific field. So you can see that we associate the XC write ID here with the configuration for the XC write ID. So we use V1 here, but yeah, in the previous slide we used G1. So sorry about that, V1 versus G1. And we associate the API with the config here. To do this, you need to determine at runtime what hardware are you using. And this can be quite hard sometimes, because, for example, some hardware versions can totally shuffle the registers, and if all the registers are shuffled, it might not be very obvious that you're using that the hardware which you're using is very similar or perhaps mostly the same. Okay, and then we have a usage of the API, which is like we're very simply writing some values via the regmap field API. And this can be used by the core driver logic, and that doesn't care anymore about the specific layout of the hardware. Yes. So I written a blog post about this, which goes a bit more in depth, and I linked some more resources. So if you want to learn more how to define these regmaps and how they work and how the association works, maybe that blog post is a good further reading. Okay. So, we have pros and cons, and as I've said, this is not a silver bullet. You can decide, because each of these points, I think, can be also interpreted as a positive thing or a negative thing, depending on the use case. So, for example, Regmaps is a Linux-only mechanism, so it's a Linux-only subsystem. This can be a pro or a con for you. a pro can be, because it's very easy to upstream stuff using Regmaps, and if you want to upstream your drivers, it's easy. But if you want, for example, a unified driver which has like layers for each operating system, this is what typically I saw in vendor drivers. You have one layer for Linux, one layer for Windows, one layer for whatever. And using a Linux-only mechanism might be a disadvantage in that case. There are quite a lot of optional features, which are very nice. Some of them you can have like caching to speed up your register writes, to avoid like going to the hardware to get each value. You can have caching on the CPU. You can have like callbacks for a lot of stuff. You can very much control what happens when you read write registers. You can do a lot of like testing. You can have out of bounds checks. You can explicitly define which registers are read, write, or just like read or write. Usually what happens in drivers, there's this nasty bug where you write read-only registers or try to read registers, which are write-only, or you can have this problem. But with Regmaps, you could get like an error, like you, or a warning, depending on how you configure it. Look, you're trying to access a register in a way which it's not supposed to be accessed. Usually, according to the documentation, assuming the documentation is correct. Yeah. So, a good advantage of this is that it can remove boilerplate from driver code. And yes, as we saw, the layout closely resembles the datasheet, which is quite a nice feature to have. You avoid the bit manipulation. But of course, defining all the registers in this way and associating them at runtime is a bit more verbose. But what you usually do, you split the regmap code into a regmap.c file or a regmap.h file for the interface and put them separately along with the core driver code. And it's not that a big deal. You put all the regmap logic into that file. And the performance impact also depends on the use case, but typically it depends on the speed of the registers which you're trying to write, and also how often you're trying to access those registers. But the speed, it's not such a huge problem. In one of the use cases which we'll see, performance was a concern because it's about video decoding and you want to maximize the number of frames you can decode in parallel, and yeah. So the performance is in general in the low microsecond range, the performance impact of Regmaps. And that's mostly due to the Regmap Field API. It increases the number of register accesses because you do subfield writing and you don't want to lose values, sub-register writing, and you don't want to lose the values which are already present in the register. So you need to read them back and update them and then write them. And in general, it leads to more register accesses. But again, if the more register accesses are very expensive, then you can use like a caching layer, so you don't have to update frequently the hardware. Okay, so let's study some use cases. The first case study was for the Synopsys MIPI DSi host controller. So a quick introduction to the MIPI DSi. So MIPI DSi is a hardware technology to implement displays with a very simple serial interface. So it's very popular in mobile and mobile gaming and automotive, IoT and stuff like that, because it's very small and cheap and simple. Yeah, so you have like a high-speed clock. This clock typically is in megahertz. I just randomly remember that on IMX6 it's 27 megahertz, but it can also reach into the gigahertz range. And that clock drives the display data on multiple serial lanes. So you need at least one data lane. That data lane can be reversible, so the panel which you connect the host controller to can also send data back. And you can have multiple data lanes. Typically you have two data lanes or four data lanes. And the access via these data lanes, it's also serialized. Like you send multiple bits in parallel, but it's still like a serial transfer. You send bit 0, 1, 2, 3, and then you send 4, 5, and so on. Okay. And there are Silicon IP vendors which implement host controllers. Like we have Synopsys, which was the host controller for which I worked on to like make the driver more generic. And you have the SoC vendors like NXP, ST Microelectronics, or Rockchip, which implement and add the IP to their SoC. And typically what happens, you have drivers, a lot of drivers. You have like a reference driver from Synopsys, you have a lot of vendor drivers for each SoC. Of course, each driver is a bit different because each has its own special magic and stuff like that. So in MIPDSI, it's standardized, and there are like four major versions. What we're interested in is the difference between 1.3 and 1.01. There was an upstream kernel, there still is an upstream kernel driver, which implemented version 1.3 of the MIPDSI spec. But we wanted to add support for the host controller, which is present on IMX6. And that's older than the ones present like on Rockchip and STM. And we wanted to add support. And the register interface breakages, they are mostly driven by the spec version. So registers for versions 1.30 and 1.31, which were supported by the upstream kernel driver, those are very close to each other. So it was very easy to do like bit manipulation, some quick checks, and implement the necessary support for those two hardware in the driver. But once we wanted to add support for the 1.0 controller on MX6, the register difference became quite big, and it was hard to do all this stuff in bit manipulation. So we turned to Regmaps and added a Regmap field. So it worked quite well. The patch has reached version 9 now, and hopefully it will get merged soon. I also have a blog post on the subject. You can visit it. It's the same blog post as linked earlier. I use this as a case study there. And looking at the challenges and results, so implementing the Regmap was very simple in this case. But testing on multiple system on a chips, that was harder, because when you do the initial Regmap implementation, you risk breaking the other SoCs, which you also abstract. So in my case, I only had like IMX devices, and I also needed to test on STM and Rockchip, because I modified the register accesses for them, and yeah, I introduced some regressions, but yeah, with the help of the community. So thank you very much for everyone involved, especially a big shout out to the STM microelectronics developers who tested the patch series and provided very valuable feedback and even patches which helped fix. So yeah, that was the hardest part. And you need like good testing for all the SoCs which you support and want to introduce the abstraction layer for. There was a problem with this driver that it needs some more attention. There are certain parts of the driver, like the DRM bridge layers, which need some more work. And it's quite unfortunate when you send like a patch adding this very specific new feature, or which is quite clear in scope, and when maintainers ask you, hey, can you also fix that? And yeah, so the patch series saw a bit of feature creep, so that's partly responsible for reaching version 9. But yeah, hopefully it can be picked up again and driven back to inclusion. So yeah, I think yeah, Regmaps were definitely a success story for this driver. And you can look at the code in the patch series and decide, okay, if this pattern makes sense for you or not. The main idea in this example is that we had a standard which drove the hardware IP, and that MIPDSI standard, you could test for the version in that standard for any breakages which were caused due to the standard in the hardware interface layout. So moving forward, we're gonna take a look at the VeriSilicon video decoders. These are driven by the Hentro driver, which currently is in staging, but it's in staging because of the decoder API, the user space API used for Video for Linux, that was not stable, and that has been stabilized for kernel 5.10, so 10. So it's being moved outside of staging. Okay, and the problem with video decoders is that they're very, very hard to implement driver-wise, at least for me it was hard. So this hardware is quite complex, especially compared to something like MIPDSI. Video decoders typically have hundreds of registers, and these registers are used to program the hardware to decode a specific bitstream. So the registers are very specific to an H.264 and H.265 bitstream. And yes, only the bitstream is standardized. So you have the H.264 and whatever specs, and according to those, the hardware also tends to be relatively stabilized. But of course, there's like no standard for how to write this hardware. So in this slide, you can see that I populated, it's the same slide which we used before, but I populated the lower bits, which we actually used for regmap fields. You can see that the Hentro video decoder, we had multiple versions. There were two different cores, hardware cores, which were used to decode different bitstream formats, but starting with the new version, which has totally different naming, like VC8000, the two hardware cores were merged into one. And this caused problems for the register layout, because it was heavily affected, because all the registers were squashed, and there were some quite non-trivial changes which were hard to detect. For example, to decode H.264 high profile, you needed to program the HEVC, so the H.265 registers, and you have packages like this. So yeah, we introduced the regmap layer to try and compensate for all this. So the problem was that the upstream driver only supported parts of the G1 and G2 decoder. We wanted to add support for the newer unified chips. So performance was critical for this use case. We needed to decode as many frames as possible at a high resolution. So naturally we were concerned about what kind of impact has regmaps. We measured it. So while accessing and doing its hundreds of register writes, while doing this, when setting up decoding for each frame, we had like a 20 microsecond or a bit less performance hit, and this was relatively constant because the register access patterns are mostly the same when decoding the frames. So you have to program each frame and then set a bit which tells the hardware, okay, you can start the decoding because everything has been like set up to properly decode the frame. And considering, we also measured the performance of decoding each frame from the moment Video for Linux user space gives the frame information to when the hardware sends an interrupt to the processor. So the entire time it takes to decode a frame, including the regmap programming of the registers, and that was in milliseconds. So it was like three orders of magnitude. You have microseconds versus milliseconds. So the performance impact of regmaps in this case was very much acceptable, and it was no problem. However, what we did have a problem with was that the driver was using the relaxed versions of the MMIO API. So it was using like write L, relaxed, and yeah. That was due to trying to avoid a memory barrier, because when you do normal reads and writes to memory map regions, you have memory barriers, instructions inserted to guarantee ordering. And in this case, for these video decoders, it doesn't matter in which order you write the registers, because the only thing which matters is for all the registers to be written when you set the start decoding bit. So at least in theory, you could achieve some performance improvements or battery saving by avoiding useless memory barriers. But yeah, so one of the challenges for this project was that we couldn't measure the impact of those memory barriers. So we tried also on loaded and unloaded systems, and yeah, typically our measurements were in the noise range for relaxed versus non-relaxed MMIO writes, at least in this use case. The problem with this is that Regmaps upstream, and they only have for the MemMIO backend, they only have normal writes, they don't have a relaxed API. It's very simple to add an API for that. You just set a config and you do relaxed writes. It's very simple. But the problem is you need a good reason to justify that API addition, because it's not there in the upstream kernel for a reason. Nobody uses it. And we're introducing the first use case for that. And it's you need a very good reason, and at least you need to have some measurements. At least in theory, it's a good reason. Okay, we want to avoid those useless mem barriers. But yeah, it might not be enough. So this is why the first patch, I haven't sent the patch series at the time at which I'm recording this video, but by the time this conference happens, the patch series will be public, and the first one will be an RFC asking about, okay, does it make sense to add this MMIO interface to Regmap? Oh, okay. And another problem which we had, which was like the biggest problem, was figuring out the hardware differences between the older revisions of the core and the newer revisions. But that's different from the Regmap. The problem there was the new core was programmed differently than the old one, and we had like to guess, okay, for some H.264 high profiles, you needed to use the H.265 fields, which was very non-trivial. Yeah. Okay, so that's about it about this. So the Regmap part of this patch was also simple and very similar to the other MIPDSI series. So yeah, you can see between these two series, you can see a good example of how this API can be used. A problem Hentro has is that it defines its own abstraction in parallel with Regmaps. It has Hentro Reg, it has that driver. And we haven't removed all the Hentro Reg structure reference to delete the structure, but yeah, that's like a work in progress. And ideally, drivers should not try to implement their own Regmaps with their own abstraction and their own masking and stuff like that, because you already have Regmaps in the kernel. Okay, so ways forward from here. So as I said, Regmaps are quite widely used in the kernel, but not necessarily to abstract register layouts or hardware details like this. And they can be used like this, and a lot of boilerplate can be removed from a lot of drivers. But of course, this needs driver developers to actually convert the drivers to use Regmaps and define the APIs. And you can have like init helpers. If you look at the patch series, the initialization, especially if you have like hundreds of Regmap fields, you have to initialize each one and you have to define configurations for them, and you have, it's like quite a lot of boilerplate code, and helpers can be added for that, especially if you have multiple drivers using it and you can remove a lot of code by doing it. And we have upstream maintainer buy-in for these patches, so hopefully they will hit Regmap soon. And maybe in the future, and this is just like an idea, I'm not proposing like hardware abstraction layers in the kernel, but maybe we can have like some standardized Regmap field APIs for various types of hardware, like for video decoders, because video decoders, they all basically have a lot of common logic and a lot of common registers. They have to set, like, for example, the bit depth of the bit stream, is it an 8-bit or 10-bit stream, and they have to set those registers, and you can have stuff like a unified API to do that via regfield API. So yeah, basically this is it. So thank you very much for attending. So I hope this RegMap mechanism for extracting registers might be useful to you, or at least an interesting use case for, hey, look how we can implement that, or how we can avoid re-implementing that. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask and or send an email. And thank you very much for your time. So bye-bye.